big issue. These guys really, wow, they have fallen out quite significantly. And today was going to be a fun championship match between the two best Russian players. I was worried about them not playing competitively, but there's no worry anymore.
Yeah, they're going to be going straight into it, aren't they? It's kind of sad. I mean, it's going to set this up to be a very good game. We've got two players here who are easily like the top two players in Russia. They've been top two players globally many, many times. Jove was the first person to hit number one in all five factions, but he's playing up against Nagano, who's been famous throughout Code 1 and 2. And when they're playing together as friends, you know, you get this sense of like they're really good, they train together, you see them picking bits of each other apart that they're familiar with. Now it's got this element of just pure aggression, like they're not going to hold anything back. I am really excited for this. This is going to be one of the best games I think we've casted in a while. I'm really glad Relic decided to push this through. That's very good idea, Relic. Good idea.
Yeah, I'm not too sure we can say why Relic are involved in this quite yet until next week, just to hold your hats till next week, possibly. But yeah, Relic are supporting the GCS, and this is one of the things they wanted to happen. They originally wanted Devem Nagano, but Devem was playing yesterday, so I suggested Jove Nagano, and Kyle was all over it. He loved it. So yeah, we're having that match instead. It's going to be absolutely off the chain. And these two guys couldn't play in GCS, Dan. Nagano, exams, Jove is going to be in the army as of next Sunday.
Yeah, it's a huge shame, to be honest. What can you do? That's the way of life.
Is it? In Russia, it maybe. I mean, we don't have to go into the army as conscripts. Nagano literally has to go into the Russian army Nagano's already done his stint. So what I just said, I misspoke, but it's actually true. Nagano's already been in the army. Jove is now doing his year in the army starting next weekend.
Really? I don't get it, but anyway, the game has started, so let's get straight into the action. We're here with game one of today, the Russian show match, Jove versus Nagano. Nagano's going to be playing from the south side of Crossroads. We saw some pretty interesting games on here yesterday.
We did indeed. We've got Nagano as the Soviets from the south. We've got Jove as the northern OKW player. These are no longer friends. These guys have legitimately, I swear on my family's life, fallen out this week big time. Very difficult to get them to play together today. This is a best of three series. Winner gets 70 great British pounds, and the loser gets 30. So it's a £100 prize pool for a best of three between two players that could not play in the GCS. One was in the army and one's having serious end of university exams. Dan, what are your predictions?
My predictions are 50-50 on this because Jove has always been one of those players that has absolutely excelled in this game. But Nagano is he's kind of like the new Barton. He is the comeback king. And Nagano is just solid, absolutely consistent in all the games that we ever cast. Matchup between Soviets and OKW, I think probably stands in Nagano's favor. He's already gone into Von Ivan's strat that we saw yesterday with the three engineers, so he's going to be very, very quick on the field against OKW. Tough to predict.
He is going to be quick on the field. He's going to get that tier one working for him. M3s are going to be ubiquitous with Soviet play in around the GCS meta. This is the GCS patch, by the way. To be honest, I tried. Jove was a little bit... He hasn't read the patch notes. I tried to tell him, if you play in GCS patch, the Faust will not come on the field if the truck is not set up. Hopefully he understood me. Hopefully Google Translate did not fail me.
Yeah, I guess he's at a bit of a disadvantage there because it's actually normally Nagano that would translate these kind of things.
Google Translate's been very good, by the way. Nagano was like, holy crap, you can speak Russian? He didn't notice it was Google Translate, so yeah. I'll put in Steam chat what I said to them both, if you want to read it. If you can Google Translate it, you'll see what it says. There's the Krillic. I believe it says something like, you two stop this now, we're going to pay you to play a stupid computer game today, put your differences aside, and just play, basically. Because otherwise this thing was not going to happen. So there you go, we've got the Folks Grenadiers coming down the east in force. Joe's going to try and push Nagano off his fuel point.
It's a nice aggressive push from OKW on the right-hand side. Two squad of Volksgrenadiers going to try and get as much of the resource decap as possible at the start of the game. And Nagano straight in with the tier 1 penals. Then there's going to be a scout car potentially countering the Kubel that's on the other side of the map. So looks like a pretty good start for Nagano, actually. I'd say he's definitely got things underway. Only got to play up against three Volks Sturm Pioneers. Nothing really going to be able to stop the scout car straight away.
nothing. That's what we've been talking about in Balance Threads and Coated Org this very day. M3s are going to be extremely powerful against OKW. You are going to have to be a little bit defensive until you get your battle group headquarters up. The M3 is going to be a tyrant. It's going to roam around the field pushing you off. And until your Raketan is up, or until you have a good counter up in terms of Faust, you are going to have to be a little bit scared of it. And that's just the way the cookie crumbles in the early game. Soviets OKW.
It really is another thing that I like about the triple engineer start, because I guess when you're playing versus OKW, here we go, he's got the scout car pushing in there, an early mine from Jove goes off, triggering the scout car, perfect counter, you knew exactly where that was going. I don't think that was intended for the scout car, that was probably intended for a squad, but maximum value came out of that. Great play
you
there.
You won an argument on a forum and instantly, because I said mine's the perfect counter, because you've got nothing else to spend your munitions on as OKW in the early game. And this guy, Australian Magic, I believe, was arguing with me. And that's a perfect example of, there you go. The shoe mine, great tool, is OKW. Play defensive against the M3 and you just might end up coming out on top.
It's absolutely classic Jove just to be prepared for everything right from the start of the game. Traps 3 or 4 minutes in, you have no chance to push against him. But I mean, what I was going to say before with the engineers is that like, you want to get as much manpower value down from OKW so that they don't have free resources to get a Raketan or something like that, you know, or get to the OKW tech structure quickly for the Fausts. So it's a nice little opening, but completely negated there by Joe.
Smashed it. These two players are going to be sorely missed in the GCS tournament. Through no fault of their own, they could not enter. They would have loved to, but it's so great to see them playing each other today. These guys are absolute giants to come here as two seen. For very, very different and very good reasons. They both play tactically differently, but they're expert level players.
Guys, he's so fortunate to still have that Kubel. Nagano's only got 7 munitions. He's only got income of 27 per minute. He's not going to be able to lay mines down to get that same kind of effect over the Kubel. You know, meanwhile, we've then got Jove. He's just gone into breakthrough tactics. Going to be pumping out those Panzer Fusiliers. Going to have plenty of munitions for the G43 upgrades. That's a really, really rough start now for Nagano.
It's going to be a really rough start indeed. And Jove, by the way, is marching back up to those first number one on all ladder ranks yet again. Just before he leaves for the army, seems he wants to get his ladder ranks to be number one in all 5 factions yet again. He's number 2 and number 1 in nearly every single one at the moment. So yes, he's on form and he's here to say, I may be leaving for the Red Army. And it's not called the Red Army, sorry, the Russian Federation Army. I am one of the daddies of the game, so there you go.
I feel like we should point out, A hasn't been through sensitivity training or any kind of casting.
You'll be surprised, Russian patriotism when it comes to the patriotic war of the Second World War and all that kind of era.
Oh yeah.
They love it. They absolutely love it. You have to go... They don't mind us saying that, like, when you get Mazza wearing Soviet costume on stream. They love it, man.
Just had the Panzer II Lukes come on the field. Excellent choice here to be able to deal with the penal battalions. And he's probably going to realize Nagano does not have the resources to start upgrading these with the PTRS, which leaves a gaping hole in Nagano's teching right now because he just doesn't really have anything to counter the light vehicles at the moment. No, even if he goes with the satchel, he can't finish it off, can he?
No, and maybe he won't notice it. Well, I don't know. Of course Nagano will know, but it's such a tricky thing to remember to pull off at the moment. It's not ingrained in Pelia's head. You have to pick the precision ability of the satchel. There's 2 satchels now to get over bugginess. One is for anti-infantry, one's for anti-tank.
Luke's coming around on a little bit of a flank. You can tell Nagano just doesn't care. If there's a mine there, I think he's well aware that the resources are not going to be available to actually finish this off. He's got minesweeper upgrades on the Stern Pioneer, so repairs go a little bit quicker now for the Axis. So anything that happens, I think, is manageable. He's going to push really, really hard.
I really think Nagano's going to have to get tier 2. He's going to have to get a Zis anti-tank gun out because he has not got enough fuel to get Tank Heavy Battalion and SU-76 or whatever it is he's going to try and wait for. I don't think penals are going to be worth the wait in order to get rid of the Lukes. I think Lukes is going to do too much damage. He needs tier 2 to stay competitive, in my opinion.
Yeah, I think you're probably right about that. He's already gone in with Lend-Lease, so I think he's probably predicting he's not going to be able to get fuel for later game teching structures. And I think that's a sensible call. It's one of the things I do actually like call-ins in this game, is that you can, it's like a little bit of a comeback mechanic. He's using it the right way here. Quite sadly, you know, all his bulletins are stacked up for sniper play, and he just hasn't been able to actually get to that because of the pressure that Joe's putting on.
That early mine, you know, MWG as we call it, mines win games. It's just put him on the back foot ever since, and he's struggling to keep hold of any based territories at the moment. He's got the good old Dushka, 300 manpower for the Maxim of old. You can't spam it, but you can use it as a... Oh my god, Fox Grenadier in the north, east there, struggling.
Looks like he'll get out of that one pretty safely. The Kubel is doing so much work here. I wonder how many caps that Kubel has at the moment. It's been all over the field, protected by the Lukes. And there's a good little synergy going on between his light vehicles, actually, because that Lukes probably isn't going to go down for a long time now. There's nothing that's going to be able to contest it whilst the Panzer II is there to support. I'm just genuinely trying to think, how is Nagano going to come back from this? We see Tier 2's gone up in the base.
Yeah, so he's got Tier 2 that we said he'd need to stay in this game. He's going to wait for 320 manpower, he's going to get his Ziss out, and then he'll be able to start contesting the battlefield once more.
I really hope maybe we see Nagano go for that same kind of trick with the, you know, maybe laying a mine down and just hoping that that Lukes, he can probably bait it into the mine, get the AT on the field, and maybe do some damage. If the Lukes stays up on the field and he isn't able to counter it, it's going to whittle down his manpower to the point he probably won't be able to get anywhere as close to the late game as Jove is.
He's 30 manpower away from the Ziss being built, and then he'll be about a minute from before the Ziss comes on the field. So by about minute 12, he should be able to start solidifying his territories once again against the... But then by that point, he'll already be down to 300 victory points. So we are going to need a little bit of a comeback from Nagano. And all the while, Jove has great fuel economy and will be able to start complementing his forces and maybe getting the Schwer up as well.
This is one of those games that really, really excites me because, you know, I know what Nagano's like. I know that this is the kind of situations he can thrive in. You know, we've seen Joe fall from pretty strong positions before. They train together, they know each other's weaknesses. So even with that, like, kind of catch-off at the start of the game, Nagano's probably going to know the right responses to make this work. He is playing sensibly, he hasn't really lost anything else. Getting good veterancy up on his units, just got to deal with the vehicle, and I think actually with the Dushkas, he's going to be fine to push up.
Yeah, Nagano, we've seen him make great comebacks in the past. He's one of those great all-round players that just has a great base game. He does all the fundamentals perfectly, and if he keeps trading, keeps jabbing, keeps in those gets through that early round onslaught from Jove, he can make it to those late rounds and really start inflicting some damage of his own.
Another tech structure coming in right now. That would actually be all three tech structures for OKW, which means King Tiger could potentially come out on the field. It's a great one to bring out with Breakthrough. Probably not going to see the Jagdjäger. Be an interesting one.
Yeah, he possibly is going for it now. Possibly will maybe give a tell from that structure, well, maybe almost a dawn or something. But Nagano already knows he's a risk.
I think that's risky because if he does go up for the King Tiger, he's basically going to have a huge window of not having late game vehicles where he could be rushing, you know, something out from the Tier 4 very quickly. So I think he's either going to go maybe into a Panzer 4 or something like that.
Yeah.
If he goes straight for King Tiger, he's going to leave like a huge time window where Nagano could potentially pull something off.
Nice Model 42 nade from the Panzer Fusiliers, but they are going to have to retreat through a hailstorm of fire. Lukes is going to come up to back. Nagano, despite everything we thought, he has not gotten anything from Tier 2 quite yet. He went for another Dushka call-in and didn't get the Ziskun we expected. So a little bit odd there, I might say. Not quite what we expected.
It looks like he's potentially just going for the Penal PTRS. They've got 80 guns in the build now. It's late. It's very, very late at 12 minutes, 23 seconds. He's going to have to. I wonder if he actually doubles up AT guns. Double Dushka, yeah, double AT guns. It's a big pushing force.
But don't forget, he gets the M4C Sherman in 3.5 command points time. So he doesn't necessarily have to double up on the AT guns quite so much if he can get that Sherman on the field in good time.
That looks like Nagano is actually starting to stabilize on the map a little bit now. It looks like he's got good control of his point here. Just lays a demo charge on the right fuel, just in case Joe comes back with the Panzer Fusiliers.
Yeah, he's managed to solidify his territories now. The Luke's has been a little bit more cautious, and it's for good reason, as this is rolling up on the field. We're now waiting for Jove's next piece of tech. He's got the Schwer Panzer headquarters on the field. He's got ample fuel. He can go for a Panzer Fear if he would like one.
Dushka in the center house, about to take an incendiary nade. That will force them out of the building, and that will mean Jove can come back through the center again. I think the AT gun walking up to the center is in pretty—it's in a lot of trouble here if it gets caught up by the Vox and the Panzer Fusiliers.
Yeah, backpedaling away, using reverse, keeping behind the shield. He's going to stay safe. Oh, the G43's plink away, managed to get rid of two of the models, but here come the penals to rescue the situation.
It was really interesting watching, because obviously the PTRS had that huge change, the difference between Guards PTRS and Penal's PTRS. So it's not that kind of effective as the infantry engagements as it used to be. We are losing
territory. No, it does drop to a couple of the SVTs, but it's still a bit of a monster, the Penal's. They're much better than the Conscripts, so you will be seeing them in pretty much every single Soviet game in this tournament, to be honest. We're sorely hoping, I think everybody is, that Conscripts can finally have a little bit of a buff in the next iteration of balance changes.
I still find it really surprising to not see Guards. I mean, I didn't really feel like the cost increase was so high that we shouldn't be seeing them. Bear in mind how, you know, effective the Doctrine is.
Yeah, I think the M5 Assault Group is a great way to bring them on, and I think it's why this command is going to be the most popular of the tournament, Lendlis. It's got a lot to it. We saw it in games yesterday with Von Ivan.
Yeah. You make a good point there about the half-track Guards, because they have completely different statistics to the PTRS Guards. In fact, their veterancy buffs are incredible.
Yeah, they have a lot of the defensive capabilities, but a completely different weapons profile. Really, really interesting unit, to be honest.
There's that Panzer IV we were talking about earlier, so I think that's a good choice. Get that out in the field, make it just a little bit harder for Nagano to keep pushing back, instead of leaving that huge window up to the King Tiger where the M4C Sherman could come in and start causing some damage. Now he's got a little bit more control over the situation. But the game is starting to even out a little bit. 250 VPs has been taken off already, but Nagano is able to twist the situation, starting to get some mines down, defend his area. He's playing very, very strategically at this point to try and prevent Jove from becoming overwhelming.
I think because it's a best of three this game match, by the way, it's best of three today. I think it's a very exciting game one, because we've seen a lot of cautious play in the early game, which probably is going to lead up to a fantastic late game.
Did you see that? Are you seeing this? Right, so he's using the Kubel here with the infantry awareness, you know, like the detection ability. He's seen Nagano's engineers are in a static position there, and he's taking guest shots just in case Nagano's planting mines, which he was, right?
Yeah,
that is like super level play. It really, he can't see that, you know, he can't have any vision. He's just literally spotting it through the fog of war with a detection and taking a guess that that's what Nagano's doing. That's
very
really,
cool.
Really smart.
Smart play, smart players. Oh, the Tuska nearly gets eviscerated by the Panzer Fear there. Has to evacuate the garrison, not in time though! Crumbling down around it, that's one dead Tuska.
Oh, that's a huge unit to lose there. Didn't manage to get it out with the low health of the building. It's starting to crumble.
Thanks everybody for the support of GCS yesterday. We're nearly at 6k. The prize pool has increased, so check out the tourney brackets to see the prize pool. Thanks for supporting the stream and for the subscriptions we've had whilst the stream's been active. But the bigger picture here right now is a fantastic game between two, quite frankly, Russian juggernauts of the game, as the Panzer II comes against the Vet 3 combat engineer, needs to get the hell out of there, and keeps him penned in on the west side of his base.
Finally got that M4C Sherman on the field from Nagano, straight into that call, and it's going to help him deal with the Panzer II and the Panzer IV as well. We don't really have any other AT on the field aside from anything that can deal with this aside from that Panzer IV. So he's going to have to play the M4C Sherman carefully just in case of Faust. Always got support of the AT gun. I think that puts Nagano in a strong position for the moment.
Yeah, it really does. The M4C is going to be able to do a lot of work with a great profile first. Faust comes in, possibly waiting now for the anti-tank rifle.
potentially could see that demo go off on the right fuel at the moment. I think Nagano knows he's not going to get the full squad if he does detonate it now.
Yeah, and probably wouldn't have got it on retreat either, so that's the wise thing to do. 90 munitions. Sternpine is probably not going to sweep it for a while, so he's got another crack at that later in the game.
Seen quite a large retreat there from Jove. It looks like he lost a number of engagements against Nagano. This is a really good point for Nagano to start pushing the field a little bit whilst there's no presence from Jove in the center. Lux is under repair at the moment. Vet 2. Panzer 4 is going to have to hold it alone. There's not that much aggression, I think. I wonder if Nagano feels he doesn't have enough on the field right now to push.
Just the best of three, I think. And because it's a grudge match and they absolutely hate each other's guts at the moment. So everybody tune in, and these two players have legitimately fallen out with each other. It was extremely difficult to get them to play today. Don't know why that is. It's a bit sad considering they've been friends for so long and one's leaving for the army next weekend. But that's what it is. So this is now a Russian grudge match between Nagano and Jove. Winner gets £70, loser will get £30 only. £100 prize pool provided by Relic Entertainment Incorporated.
Are we adding Incorporated onto them now?
Yeah, I think it's hilarious. Because on the legal disclaimers they gave me for the Kickstarter, because they didn't want to be associated with the Kickstarter, for some legal reason, not because of a personal reason, they made me say, well, they gave me the spiel and it said Relic Entertainment Incorporated, so that's how I refer to them. You don't think it's funny?
I don't know, it's fine.
Didn't
even know.
Well, a lot of mines around here in the north. Got to be a little bit careful of pushing too far up.
Yeah, he's got the minesweepers there. I think he just needs to push a little bit further forward in order to spot those, give himself a little bit of intel as he moves in. Just wondering, because we do have... I mean, Jove's been stacking munitions for the majority of this game. He's had so many at the start. He's going to be able to use the assault artillery. We'll be able to use the assault artillery to drop that on that strategic point down the center. And once the smoke shells start coming in, it'll be a really good opportunity for him to run in with the Panzer Fusiliers, Volksgrenadiers, start going in close range, dropping the incendiary grenades. He could cause a lot of chaos just from a good use of this ability. So hopefully we get to see Jove setting up on his side, setting up for a pretty good flank. Nagano's going to have a lot to deal with when he does drop that.
Dan, do you really still really fancy the Königstiger over the Jagdtiger?
Not when you've got already a unit out of tier 4. I think you've got like a Panzer 4 and a Jagdtiger, and you've got a great combination there, just because one can scout. I mean, even the Lux, if you were to use the camouflage on the Lux and use that as a spotting unit,
yes.
Do you know what I mean? You can get some great work out of that. So the Jagdtiger would be a really cool choice. I just think King Tiger, you know, it's a little more flexible, isn't it?
Just whilst Nagano's a little bit penned in, do you know this hedge where the Kugel is right now? I predict this hedge is going to be one of the most dominant map features in the entire tournament, because it's such a good hedge for attack grounds, such a good hedges for a lot of features. I want to name it by at least the quarterfinals. So if anybody can think of a good name for that particular hedge, which I think is one of the most dominant features in any map in Glamira's 2, just give it a name in chat and we might think of christening it that. Never a dull moment. We'll see rocking around the west. It would have spotted those mines. Hull Gunner manages to cripple a few of the Stimpineers here because of Panzer Fear. Turret not currently facing its intended target. There you go, it's now traversing. Gets a shot off, misses.
Yeah, I think a lot of shots are actually missed there by the vehicles. Of course, there's so much movement going on. Accuracy penalties come in and they just don't manage to land targets quite as they want to. But the Raketen did get a shot off on the M4C. And Nagano's playing this unit very, very carefully. Can call another one in at the moment, and for some reason a little bit hesitant. He has teched up to tier 3. I wonder if he's going to go tier 4, maybe SU-85, just for the safety of just in case that King Tiger does come out on the field.
I think the M4C Shermans aren't going to be able to handle that 60-ton, 70-ton BM off when it comes onto the field, so you might be right there. I think an SU-85 is always good a tool to get with that, but then he goes to the M4C Sherman anyway.
The M4C Shermans are great for flanking. Like, you can get really far behind the lines, but there's a lot of fausting that can go on from OKW. They do have a lot of resources stacked up, which Jove is, you know, rightfully not using at the moment, because he doesn't want to use everything in one go. It's to leave a little something for the push. Yeah, we'll see how this works.
see how it works indeed. There you go, you got assault artillery coming down on the cutoff territory. He's gonna have to vacate that Y-shaped frontier. Still got units in it, possibly doesn't realize this is gonna be pretty brutal when it hits.
Just didn't manage to get the loots there with the M4C Sherman. Nearly took a Faust from the second Volksgrenadiers. I don't think the Panzer IV is really near enough to defend from it. Here comes the assault artillery on that southern sector there. We're going to see the barrage come down first, then the smoke shells. And this could be the moment where we see Jove actually push out, but it doesn't look like he has that much on the field. King Tiger is in. So I think he's made the wrong choice, not going for that SU-85.
What a beautiful tank. Look at that with that camo. The Königstiger, the Tiger II, the Royal Tiger, the Bengal Tiger, the Panzerkampfwagen 6. Bay, I think. I don't know. There's a lot of names to this thing, Dan. But one thing can be assured. It's a big fat fuck that sits on the center of the map, soaks up pressure and deals out pain.
Yeah, it's a pretty heavy unit. I don't really know what he's going to do here. Well, we're going to find out. I mean, this is a squad wiping machine, so he's got to be careful. He's got a lot of the engineers still on the field. Four-man squads, really some of the most susceptible to these squad wipes from the King Tiger's AoE shells. And what has he got? He's going to have to do... I think he's going to have to do that tech up. We've got an AT gun that's moving up through the center. I think, was that a squad wipe? That was engineers, yeah.
Yeah, this thing's going to be a monster, an absolute monster. It's already got two kills, just wiped the squad to get its pimple mantle upgraded. SU-85, an absolute necessity. In the meantime, he's going to have to get the Ziss out just to contend the center.
I think he's just found his moment. I think he's just found a moment he wants to go in. Looked like the King Tiger showed its rear armor for a second, and Nagano was straight on the ball there, saw an opportunity. Penal battalions rushing in, they're not going to be able to get a satchel charge on it, but they will take some shots with the PTRS.
Oh, here comes the cavalry though, the anti-infantry tanks, the Panzer IV, the Lukes, the ISG giving backing support, the Penal don't stand a bloody chance.
Yeah, nice little attempted push. We've got two AT guns on the field now, two M4C Shermans, he's just trying to hold the front line, VPD capped in the middle, so it's still kind of 50-50 on where this is going at the moment. Jove isn't quite strong enough to push yet, he doesn't feel confident, and he has spent all his resources. I honestly thought he would have used assault artillery a little bit better than how he used it, you know, maybe to support the push, but he just didn't back it up with anything.
I think he put on too narrow a strip of territory, in all honesty. That was a Y-shaped, very thin territory. Nagano looked at his map. Here you go, the action's heating up again. Panzer IV is in position. The Raketenwerfer's watching out. The Panzer Fusiliers are giving sight. And then the King Tiger in the background, just waiting. Another demo on the west, by the way, to keep an eye on.
Oh, yes. Nice barrage from the AT gun. Raketen's trying to pick out that M4C Sherman. Putting so much pressure on Nagano whilst he's trying to repair these, and Nagano's really, really susceptible to a push right now. Any play from the Panzer IV that rushes in, if they can just find a way to negate the AT guns, will easily be able to deal with the M4C Shermans.
Mine blows up, it destroys that Panzer Fusilier squad.
Oh, that's a good pickup. That's a very good pickup.
It is, but what isn't very good is his victory point count right now. He's getting slowly tweaked down. He's now 185 to 462. He's against OKW, heavy late game, and it's going to be a very difficult proposition.
He's getting slowly caged in. I mean, this is a very, very strong position for OKW to be in when you've got, you know, when you've got the King Tiger out in the field and you have medium tier support for it. It's a very, very strong combination, very, very difficult to beat. Nagano hasn't quite, at least I don't think he's really been able to tech up in the appropriate way to deal with this. You know, it'd be good to see tier 4, it'd be good to see like a Katusha or an SU-85. We don't have those, we've got two M4C Shermans, which are just going to get fausted and quite frankly destroyed.
It was a complete build order misplay. He needed an SU-85 and then possibly a Katusha or a secondary M4 after he had the tank destroyer. Right now he's up against something he doesn't quite have the tools to deal with in King Tiger. He can't really push the center as much as he'd like.
I guess the best thing for him to do right now is to maybe try and lay as many mines as he can and just keep holding the repair front line with the M4C Shermans.
Yeah, he's got to do... He can't be too defensive though, because as I say, the victory point count's getting low, and here comes the OKW army. Jove senses blood, he's getting close in. M4C stuck in the shed. He's gonna get another big shot in there from the King Tiger's main armament. 8.8 millimeter smashes through the rear armor of the Sherman.
Yep, this is looking like it might be the GG push there. Loses the AT gun, one of the M4C Shermans down, the other is Fausted and completely helpless to defend in the situations. Engineers go down with the flamethrower upgrade. Nagano's manpower army is getting weaker and weaker. The King Tiger's going to be pushing that strategic cutoff further and further. I love that he's focusing these AT guns as well. If he can destroy these, even less that's going to be able to counter the force of the King Tiger.
So for everybody watching, if you're worried about how to play OKW in the GCS patch that's soon to hit, this is exactly how you play them against the aggressive Soviet early game. Be a little bit defensive, weather the storm, and then you've got the Krupp style to just wreck your opponent in the late game.
We have to say, though, I mean, let's just be totally honest. This whole game kind of stemmed from one mine that happened at the start of the game. Jove using his first 30 munitions to lay a mine on his strategic cutoff, which killed the scout car, and it just rolled Nagano's entire strategy. You know, he's got sniper bulletins. We didn't see a single sniper or anything like that. You could see where he was going with it, and it didn't work. So amazing first 5 minutes play from Jove, and he just steamrolled the rest of the game there.
He's the Russian steamroller. 1-0 up in a best of three grudge match. Let me say it again, grudge match. The things these guys were saying to each other in Russian letters earlier was pretty horrendous when I put it into Google Translate. Jove's 1-0 up.
Good game. Very good game. Good start to the day, actually.
Yeah, it's absolutely wonderful. So that now means that, of course, Nagano is going to be on probably OKW on Crossroads against his former friend. So let's just see what Jove goes for. He's very famous for playing, to be honest, all five factions. He could be going Brits, Soviets, USF. Let's see.
I assume you're on the battle planner, is that right?
To be honest, I don't think the guys will be using the battle plan. I just did that to set it up.
Oh, okay. Back in the game for me then.
Have a link for you. Yes.
Yeah, all right. We'll wait for the game. They may have started already because I think we're a little late looking into that game. No, they haven't. Not yet. No, it's cool.
Yeah, I'll have to investigate where they're up to with this one. Hang on a second.
Babista, yeah, Jove is not playing in the GCS. This is an arranged show match, something which was the idea of Relic Entertainment. Put aside a little bit of prize money for these, because they are two very prestigious players who we are going to miss in the tournament. We do feel they deserve a spot in the limelight, because they've been huge contributors to the tournament scene. So, yeah, this is to do with Relic, their idea, and going to be a good series.
It really is, yeah. It's really good. It's going to be excellent today, in fact. Just to confirm for everybody, Relic had an awesome idea. Kyle thought it'd be great to do a rematch of Devem Nagano, the final for Warpaint Championship we'd never see before, because Nagano couldn't fly out to Canada. It was really sad. Jezulin had to take his place because he had no passport. That's right, isn't it?
Yeah.
But Devem was playing yesterday, and Devem's already got GCS to look forward to. Nagano and Jove got nothing, so we decided to instead put on a show match for the big two Russian players that, through no fault of their own, couldn't play in GCS.
Yeah, it's a good... I see like some comments in chat, and that's not the case that Relic is not doing anything for the community, because they are now. You know, we're getting patching, we're getting community balance, we're getting, you know, these kind of ideas and support. So they are doing stuff. I wouldn't say that this is a crowdfunded event. This isn't a Relic hosted or a Relic supported event. So, you know, for what they've actually offered on the side, yeah, I'm very happy with what they've done, to be honest.
It's really good. It takes pressure off the crowdfunded aspects as well. So we can just concentrate on the tournament and on the making the live event happen. But Relic helping out on the sidelines, they've been patching the game. They are funding little things like this. They're going to help us put emblems and faceplates in the game. Loads of cool stuff. They're helping with the tournament. They gave us the artwork, the logo, because my original artwork was great, but a little bit amateurish, a little bit kind of guy on the internet on Photoshop making stuff,
a
not professional.
Bit
not a caster with 10 minutes Photoshop experience using masking tools or
Shut up.
Sorry. But yeah, the legal spiel I've been given. Whereas we're pleased to have the support of Relic Entertainment Incorporated in making this initiative happen, we should point out that the Kickstarter project, related rewards, prizes and competition rules are not controlled or provided by Relic Entertainment Incorporated. Does that remind you of what ESL Day's done?
I treated ESL the same way, just kind of whoosh, over my head. Just let me cast.
Yeah, same. Yeah.
But
I love it, though. Absolutely love it.
1 minute left till this game starts. Second game coming in. It's best of three at the moment. Drove's got one game in hand. You guys, I think, yeah, a lot of people know what's going on anyway, but it's going to be Brits versus OKW, Jove's Brits. We saw Jove play Brits before, actually, against Theodosius. We saw Theodosius crack that pretty hard, so we know it's not an unbeatable strategy Jove's got going on, is it?
It isn't, no. Jove is a hell of a strong Brit player. Nagano is probably one of the strongest OKW players the game's ever seen. He made playing OKW on Garrison Heavy maps a possibility for a lot of players, so this is a big match, and Nagano's got to win it. Just as an update to the Kickstarter, guys, the Kickstarter's looking very handsome at the moment. Nearly 6K, just refreshing now, £5,910, which is all going to go into the tournament. Absolutely epic. The prize pool has risen, that's right. We're now up to £1,400 for the winner. £650 for the second place, £300 for third, £140 for fourth. So it's looking absolutely awesome. And without further ado, I think it's time to start game two.
All right, let's do it. Game two, Jove versus Nagano. This time Jove is going to be playing Brits on the south side of Crossroads. And his opponent, Nagano, OKW from the north.
Yeah, Nagano has got to win this game. This is a grudge match. I'll repeat it for anybody just tuning in. These guys have legitimately fallen out big style this week. Not talking to each other. A hell of a lot of Russian swearing that I had a sneakily Google translated when I was trying to get this game on. Yeah, this is a grudge match. Very difficult to get them to play today, but they are playing. They're playing for money. Winner gets £70. The runner-up gets £30. It's a show match for the Russian Heavyweight Championship of the world. And go on, Dan, give me some predictions.
Well, my honest prediction for this game is that we're going to see Nagano playing Special Operations for OKW. I'm going to make that prediction now. I think it's a very, very good commander. It's very good if you want to play light vehicles and then kind of go into a Panther Call-In without having the Tier 4. And Tier 4 doesn't really give you the kind of defensive values it used to. It's not like you can really stick Tier 4 up and have it be amazing. Then again, you know, versus Brits, you could leave it on the left side and have it covering VP fuel efficiently. But I think he'll probably go with Special Operations. Very comfortable. Mark target, of course. Very, very good on that unit. Hasn't it had some changes?
Yeah, I'm just actually getting those changes up as we speak. Coordinated fire has been both simultaneously nerfed and buffed. It's now at 25% damage instead of 50, but it's also got 25% increased pen. It's just a little bit different, that vehicle. So we'll be seeing a lot of that today. And, you know, hopefully it should give us a feel. I'm going to paste the notes in the chat for everybody. Because I'm a nice guy.
I would take a good look at those because, again, it was like a controversial change, wasn't it? A lot of that was really kind of looked into a lot. We've got a nice early trench here from Jove. Interestingly, like, I don't want to talk too much about any other games, but I would really recommend people going checking out the match between Fredbrick and Earth yesterday, because Fredbrick played this amazing, amazing tactic against trenches, where he rushed two Volksgrenadiers up to the sides of the trench and built... He basically used the ghosting. I mean, ghosting's been fixed now, so he's taking advantage that his units were nearby, quickly ghosting a triangle around the trench and trapping the Brits so they couldn't escape. It was a really beautiful high play strategy.
Very cool. On the topic of GCS patch, whilst we're just watching this very early game engagement between the Vickers and the Stone Pioneer, it's actually possibly the least controversial patch notes in the game's history. It's got 89% approval ratings. 89% approval ratings on all the workshop and surveys Relic have put out for it. which is unheard of, absolutely unheard of. So I'm really pleased with how it's been received. And I think it's actually meaning that it's had an accelerated release and we should be seeing it very shortly.
It is a great patch. And all the games that we've played so far in this patch have been leagues above in terms of strategy for what a lot of the previous patches have been, especially recently.
So what we're seeing here, we've got Kubel going very deep. We've got Folks currently is contesting against a single Tommy squad that's going to try and get into the trench on the east. So yeah, Nagano is out for blood in this game. He's playing very aggressively, fervent on the micro, and he's all over the place.
We've got a mechanized regiment coming in for Nagano. Probably going to be rushing that Luke's out to try and deal with the British infantry. It'll be Luke's maybe even a late game Stuka against the Brits. Great one for working them out of their defensive positions. I think this was the kind of strategy I was expecting though from Nagano. And I kind of think it may be a little bit obvious to Jove. This is kind of the thing where Jove would be like, I know Nagano very well. I think it's kind of assumed he's very good at playing this kind of thing. He's probably going to play it now with the safety and wanting to beat Jove. So Jove should have a good idea of how to counter this.
The universal character, universal carrier is out. Formerly known as a Bren carrier, it's now a bloody Vickers carrier, and it's going to suppress these Folks Grenadiers, given time, push them off that cutoff. And it's always a unit to watch out for when it's got this upgrade, because it can actually be surprisingly fierce.
It's a really nice early counter, but of course Nagano has got the tech structure up now, so he does have access to Faust. The Bren carrier needs to be Vickers. Do you know, I've always called it Bren carrier just from Co 1.
But it is most likely known as a Bren carrier. It's just Inco 2, it upgrades a Vickers. So it's the Vickers carrying Bren carrier. Or the VCBC, as you can call it. Or the VCBCUC. Because obviously it's a universal carrier.
I'll just call it the UC. I think it'll be fine.
Well, it does carry a lot of things, so UC would be most apt. Men, it can carry men as well. Amazing. And a flamethrower down.
I mean, the Wasp, I love seeing the Wasp upgrade on this. I really do. I think it's a really nice long-range flamethrower. They can just, like, really in the early game, just disrupt loads of support combinations. But a lot of people just don't use it. I guess he just wants to have the kind of mobile harassment to just make sure those Volksgrenadiers lose their health, let the Brits get into some good cover positions and finish off those engagements. A little bit of a trouble situation for the Kubel here. I'm not sure who's going to win this engagement, really, because as soon as the Brits hit that green cover behind the tractor, their high rate of fire goes in, they should be able to deal some decent shots, but Nagano's pushing the squad out of cover constantly.
That's exactly how the Kubel can defeat pretty much any infantry squad that doesn't have an anti-tank capacity. Basically, with pushing, you can actually keep the Kubel's DPS up and keep the unit from firing. If they're moving around and being pushed around, they're in an animation caused by the game, and they can't fire their rifles. So players like Devem be expecting them to use light scouting vehicles quite a lot in this tournament.
Nagano is trying to get away with a cheeky mine through the center there. Spotted, I think, by the engineers. He's decided to leave it but not cancel it, so I think he's possibly thinking that he'll go up for that one again. And we see the Lukes come in on that universal carrier. There's no way that that's getting out of there alive. Lovely.
No escape. No escape from the Lukes. Panzer 2 has just absolutely smashed that universal carrier, and now it's going after the Vickers, so Nagano is already making a great start to this game.
What do we see on the teching front from Jove? Is he going for the AEC, or is he locked into something else at the moment?
Right now, he, of course, does have the Platoon Command post up.
Yeah,
the possibly. Yes, he's got the AEC, yeah. You asked me, I was looking for you.
Sorry, it was taking too long.
I was just looking, I have small eyes.
I'm sorry.
They take longer to traverse in my...
Next time, I'll let you do it, I'm sorry.
It's like you asked a disabled child to do something for you, and then when he can't do it fast enough, you say, "Oh, I'm just doing it anyway." You're merciless, absolutely merciless.
I'm sorry.
It's okay. We'll get over this, Dan. This is just another marital issue, much like Nagano and Joe, seemingly. Except we don't shout nasty things at each other in Russian.
Oh dear. Well, the AEC is going to come out at the same time as the Puma, by the looks of it, and. I really love this combination. Like, Nagano is once again, as an OKW faction, rolling the faction very, very well into the Brits. AEC is going to be there to counter the Lukes, but then the Puma's going to be countering the AEC, and it's going to turn into a pretty interesting game whilst... why have you written that?
It's a show match. We can be a little bit more jovial. Thank you for the subscription, you know?
Oh, okay. Sorry. I was just trying to class this seriously. Thank you. Thank you for the subscription, McCafferty.
Oh, here
thank
we go.
You
the AC's going in for the loot. The Puma's coming out there, Dan. It's going to push around the brink of that house. But smoke is popped. Puma's still going for it. Attacking the frontal armor. It's going to juke behind the hedge. Still manages to get it, and there you go. What a great assault by Nagano. So the counter to the Lukes has just been countered in kind, and that means Nagano is sitting pretty.
That was a really, really nice counter prediction play, because he has the Lukes out. I guess he thought, hey, Jove's going to think there's no way he's going to go anything else from the mechanized, so I'm going to, you know, get that AEC out, deal with the Lukes. But no, yes, Nagano threw in a little bit of a curveball. He said, I'm going to get the counter out for what I think you're going to counter me with. Came out in good time. Wrecked his opponent. So Jove is hugely on the back foot right now, trying to get everything he can ready in base. Gonna have to go for the AT gun because his fuel is gonna have to wait for late game units like the Cromwell. And a pretty difficult position for him to be in.
It really is. By the way, on the right fuel, we did see a Folk's Grenadier go down. A little tiny bit of parity was kept. But in terms of vehicles down, Nagano's just looking absolutely merciless here. It has been said before, by the way, that the two Russian guys are by far better OKW players. Players such as Hans and such, Loveness, they always talk about Nagano and Jove as OKW players. Barton mentioned it as well in balanced discussions. You got to shout for the Russians with their OKW, he was saying.
I completely agree with that. They're some of the best OKW players. I always actually put Jove down as the best OKW player during ESL. Because he had that amazing double Rocket and double Osprey strategy that he was rolling out, do you remember, through like Kolodny Firma, which was just, you know, OKW was in a little bit of a weird place at the time and he was just wrecking with it. And now it's kind of in the hands of Nagano, really.
Yeah, I agree. The 6-pounder there making an indentation on the Panzer II. But obviously it's just one AT gun. It's up against STGs now. Keeping Jove penned into base. I believe, Dan, we're already going to a deciding game here, possibly, if Nagano can keep the momentum up. However, you can never count Jove out, especially in 10 minutes.
No, not at all. He's still got a reasonable amount on the field. We've just seen the Tommies with anti-tank rifles come in, so putting a little bit more AT on the field that isn't vehicle-based, which I think is a sensible idea, given that, you know, these are only light vehicles. They will go down to that kind of play with the right tactics.
There you go, 6-pounder doing some work in the east, keeping the Puma away. These vehicles are going to have to relinquish their foothold and go back to the mechanized. But it's all about, to be honest, Joe's got to recover and get to the point where he can get a Cromwell out or possibly get any form of vehicle out just so he can start contending properly.
Seeing another tech structure here for OKW, so we could be looking at the either the battle grouper for healing or it'll be going up to tier 4. I suspect this is going to be battle grouper and he'll go, yeah, there we go. Special operations was picked before, actually. So this is most likely going to be battle grouper.
You'll notice in base you've got those medical supplies and they're damn good. Obviously they're an APM sink and you know, you don't want to be thinking about popping medical supplies in base, so it's always possible to get the battle group off. And he has gone for it, so you're right, but the bloody medical supplies are really good now.
They are good, and I think just one of the things that allows OKW to play mechanized very, very effectively, you know, without feeling like you're losing the manpower engagements, made a huge difference to OKW in terms of their early game prowess.
It really can. It really does. So we've still got Jove penned in, just about getting his cut off under heavy fire from the Lukes, which does eat a 6-pounder shot there.
Oh! Gosh, that was right on the end of vision there. Last AT shot took it down to a very low amount of health, but once again, nothing to finish it with. Anti-tank rifles are going to be pushing the left-hand side of the field towards the Kubel rather than chasing down the Lukes, but at least it's off the field for a little while whilst the British infantry can go and recap some of the territory.
Very good comeback mechanic tool if you're penned in and you still have a decent victory point countdown. It's always been the sniper. Surprisingly, if you're consolidating your base and you've got AT to keep the opponent off your door, you can snipe them away and try and get hold of the middle ground. So it's interesting to see Jove go for that.
He's starting to make some ground back.
Yeah, already is, even without the sniper. But you'll see that the M... Gay 34s up in the east. It's gonna have to be it's gonna be tricky to unroot so much OKW presence. So the sniper definitely will help.
I'm kind of feeling at the moment that we may, it's very, very possible that we may get into a similar situation to what I was talking about last game with kind of late game teching being delayed, and it might end up with Jove having an opportunity because the Command Panther is going to come out, you know, we've still got a long time off of that. There's only light vehicles on the field. There's no chance really, I think that Nagano's going to go for anything else. So if Jove can take these light vehicles down, you know, there's only going to be a couple of Volksgrenadiers and the MG left, and Jove's got so much manpower. On the field, he's going to completely outweigh Nagano if that happens.
Jove's got a sizable front, to be honest, and both players now have parity in terms of pop caps. He's weathered the storm against Nagano. Kotu's combat mechanics have come into play with the increased manpower income when your army's a little bit lower. So there you go, we've got parity again. However, the damage has been done to the victory point count. He's down to 290. Right now, though, no, the central victory point is neutral, but Nagano has the eastern and the western victory points thanks to the MG34's great work, and now has the walking Stuka, the Stuka Zufus, on the field very shortly.
It's going to be an interesting one. Just notice that Jove has just spent his fuel on the five-man squad upgrades for Brits, so it's going to be more of a manpower drain. It's always an interesting one because... I guess he feels like he's not in a position where he's going to get vehicles out for a while, so he's going to make his squads the very best they can be as they provide all the AT on the field. I think that's sensible, but it is going to hamper his ability to get the Crocodile out late game if that's what he's going for.
Yeah, it really is. And of course he will need something a little bit better at chasing down vehicles as well, and the Croc's certainly not going to help him there. So it's going to be interesting to see what he gets in the meantime as well. Very tense game, very ponderous at times. They clearly know they're playing for money. It clearly is a massive grudge match. Whenever the players, quite frankly, have fallen out and have real bad blood, like these two do this week, you can always sense that they're a little bit trepidatious at times, and we're having a little bit of that now, but you'll always be seeing a fury of aggression when it opens up, so we're going to be waiting for that as well.
A little bit slow from Nagano right now, just trying to manage territory on the left. Has left the VP in the middle for some reason. I don't know what he's scared of capping that for. Now we're seeing the Stuka. That's firing. Looks like it's directly down the center. Is it base? Oh, base! It takes the sniper down in one of the hits.
Oh, there you go. Beautiful precision strike from Nagano. He predicted that wonderfully, and he got his just rewards, and he reaped the benefits of tactical astuteness.
It's one of the best comeback mechanics that Jove had, just wiped away by that unit. Great little, I don't want to say precision shot, but I think that was an accident. It was just very, very unfortunate.
Well, yeah, maybe it was unfortunate. We'll never know unless we actually ask Nico, I guess. It was probably luck, let's face it, but certainly is going to keep him on top in this game too, and look likely that we're heading towards that ace game decider.
Looks like Nagano is trying to, once that shot went in, I don't know if he actually clocked the sniper, went down through the fog of war, but he has decided to make a huge push, trying to get the strategic point down here to deny all resources.
Have you also noticed, Dan, there's a little 11 underneath the Command Panther on the bottom right-hand side of your screen?
I noticed that it's there, but it's not actually on the... The hover
I was a bit worried at first. It didn't say. It said and say 11 on the. Oh god! He jumped in the trench and did not die. That was a misvision by A. But yes, it is 11 command points now, not 10 as it says on the command drop down. Artillery fighting.
Coming up very close to that special operations command panther now, and that should probably. Finish the game up. I can't see any way, really. Nagano would have to make some huge mistakes to not be able to win with this combination on the field.
I gotta be honest, though. I mean, he knows he's had fuel dominance in this game. I suppose the Command Panther is a great unit and all, but it won't be a real game finisher at the moment.
it's just a big target. I think if you've got, you know, you've got light vehicles that are already doing a hell of a lot of work. You know, the Command Panther goes in first, it's high armored, it will probably bounce a couple of shots from AT as well. You're able to repair it quickly. I just think it's going to be good bait at the end of the day, if anything.
Yeah, that's always a good point. It's definitely here we go, Stukas of Foose with the second barrage. Is this going to be equally as brutal? Yes, it is! Yes, it is! Another brutal Stukas of Foose from Nagano. He's been on point, and as has his rocket artillery.
A really, really good shot. And also nearly wiping the AT gun off the field, which would be a real blow for Jove if that did happen. He needs that AT. It's really the only thing that's going to be able to push off the attacks from the light vehicles. The Stukas are a really good choice, though. Even though it's put him back loads in terms of his teching, he's still had so much map control from this build that he's going to easily meet the requirements for that Panther as soon as it unlocks.
I do believe, by the way, Nagano has slipped below what Jove had in terms of victory points. I will need to verify that. Didn't quite have my GCS refereeing hat on when I noted that. I'd noted the victory points down at 460, but I wasn't quite sure if that's what it was because I'd already closed out of the game. So we'll have to double check that with the players. But I do believe that Jove now has victory point control overall in the series, and we'll have even if he loses this, we'll have the choice. But I'm gonna have to verify that. You can't watch a VODs back until they finish, can you, on Twitch?
Yeah, you can. You can, actually.
Oh, if somebody watching this can actually watch, scroll back and see what the score was at the end of the first game, that would be very, very helpful. I do believe it's 460, but I want to double check. Sniper's been rebuilt. Danny's got the infantry heading it up for him. And there we go. The Command Panther's also come onto the field. The Panzer 5th. Beautiful tank. See one at Bobbington if you want to go down there. Tiger Day, very shortly.
I'm really wondering, I mean, does Jove really want to stay in this game right now? Oh no, I'm just kind of thinking, what is his plan here? He's so low on fuel, the infantry just aren't cutting it at the moment. He's got the 1AT gun against, I don't know, 5 vehicles on the field. He's just losing things left, right and center. Surely this is a good time to call it.
Yeah, I think so. It is a grudge match though, Dan. The unspeakable things these guys have been saying to each other. I believe one of them apologised to the other and the other did not accept the apology. That happened yesterday and then today. What would we say in Stoke-on-Trent is loggerheads. So yeah, it's a brutal situation and neither wants to lose. And if Jove can somehow eke his way back into the second game, he'll take it. He wants that 2-0 over his former friend.
Game 3. How are they selecting the maps for Game 3? So I assume they're doing
it. Will be on Thamenville approach.
Oh, perfect.
Yeah. The map pool is an order of preference for a decider, so whatever hasn't been played in GCS rules, we've got an order of preference for Thamenville, Cologne, Crossroads, and Crossing in the Woods. But to be honest, if the players would let me, I'd love to swap Thamenville and Crossroads, because I think Crossroads is a much more favoured map by everybody. It's much more balanced, in fact. Yes, Cruzy's confirmed it's 4-6-2 in the last game, so I wasn't too far off. So there you go. That would mean Jove has choice in Game 3. Sunny in chat just said every match is a grudge match. Absolutely not. That is not a promotional tactic I am employing. Legitimately, these two were arguing in Russian letters, Krillic. Is it Krillic? How do you say it, Dan? I'm sure I say it wrong.
I have no idea.
It's a kind of...
I just call it Russian language. Another huge barrage there from the Stukas of Foose, taking down the AT gun. This thing's still alive with minimal amounts of health. The Lux is going to try and push in to take the sniper down now, and it's probably going to be able to pick it up. Yes, it will. Minimal health. Vet 4, got to get that unit out of there. It's such a huge player. Look at the Command Panther coming in to defend. Huge charge in there, realizing the severity of the situation.
There you go. That's just soaking up pressure for your buddy. You can tag team with a tank and draw any not focused fire and just sometimes save the vehicle's life. And that's exactly what the Command Panther did in this situation. Look at Nagano's army. Look at his vehicle. He's got a light reconnaissance vehicle. He's got an anti-tank armored car, a rocket artillery piece half-track, a light tank anti-infantry and a heavy tank anti-tank. He's got literally one of every animal. It's like a Noah's Ark of armored fighting vehicles.
Very nice. Where did you come up with these?
I've just...
Is it some forum of just random things to say in Company of Heroes?
No, it's just that I'm eloquent and verbose and have a personality.
Wow.
Maybe you should try it sometime.
Wow. My fingers on this magical mute button that I programmed in.
Oh, it's just practice, mate. We're very, very... The good thing about us is we're equals when it comes to casting in terms of prowess and stuff. So, you know, we always cover for each other. We always, sometimes one of us is really on it, sometimes the other's lacking. And then the other next cast, it'll be the other way around. We're like cookies and cream, mate.
I like that analogy.
Ooh, what's this red smoke? They're
trying to go for a crush. That's the artillery smoke dropped down by the Tommies with anti-tank rifles. They're going to try and put artillery to land in the center and the house. And AT gun getting some good shots there off. And he got 18-8 from the Tommies. That's good. Now it's engine stunned. AT gun's going to want to move up with the engineers with the Piats. I don't think he's got quite enough to push off. The Dukas of Wuss is going to take another shot to try and get the AT gun narrowly dodged by Jove.
Just about dodged by Jove. Jove's barely staying in this thing. He hasn't even got critical mass, but what he has got, he's managing to work very well, trying to control his base territory sectors. And to be honest, my instincts tell me he doesn't know he has victory point control, so he's just making sure. Elsewhere in the east, the Luke system, a very different situation against the trench. Tommy's just get out of there. Luke's is now harassing it. Vic is also going to have to get out of there. Nagano looking dominant, looking imperious.
So nice positioning of the AT gun there, trying to pick off the Lukes as it came round. In fact, he, for some reason, he set it down and tried to reverse it a little bit, and that's allowed the Lukes to go in, potentially finish off the Vickers. He's dodging the AT gun, but there go the Pirates. There goes the AT grenade from the Tommies, and now it's stunned. Now all he's got to do is get the AT gun with a little bit of line of sight. You could start to see him come back against the light vehicle play.
Yeah, the personal infantry anti-tank, the Piat's doing excellent work there. By the way, Dan, there was a really good move by Nagano that Jove accidentally dodged. There was a Fuchs Grenadier that came down the west with infiltration nades over the bush, but the Tommies just so happened to leave the garrison at the exact right time. So it's a really good move by Nagano that unfortunately didn't pay off.
Just had the Crocodile come on the field. You can see the flares that have come in for vision. Crocodile's going to go over to the right-hand side, possibly try and clear the Volksgrenadiers off so he can quickly get a VP and stop what is basically 1 minute of gameplay left if he doesn't. This is a very tense moment for Jove, because looking at the armies, there's a very small chance that he'd ever be able to pull this back off, but he's going to go for it anyway.
The Crocodile. What a horrible, horrible vehicle. Do you know, in northern France, the Wehrmacht literally sent a letter to the British command asking for the use of this vehicle to be stopped because it was inhumane. When the Nazis are telling you your vehicle is inhumane for the nitroglycerine it's like smearing your unit's faces with, you know you're doing something right.
Where have we got this Stuka going in? One more shot, trying to get that AT gun. It's such a important target. And the Stuka has tried to narrow down the AT gun constantly throughout this game. Hasn't quite had the luck. Now we've got the Lukes trying to push in the AT gun. AT gun's had to set up. And I don't know. I don't know why he just doesn't pack down and actually take a shot with the AT gun. It would have been so much more effective. He's done so much moving around with it, and it's lost so much health. It hasn't been in a position to fire. 30 VPs remain. That's 30 seconds of gameplay left, and time is very, very slowly running out. Looks like Nagano may take a push here. Mark target goes on the Crocodile, so now we've got the new changes to this. We're going to see how that works.
Fire. It's going to be great because it's got better penetration now. 25% damage, 25% extra pen. The Boomer's coming in at the party as well. Crocodile's going to have to relinquish his position, and Nagano is reigning supreme.
Really sensible idea from Nagano there, not to push it too far. He's got good control. He doesn't need to rush this at all. All he needs to do is just sit back, let the VPs drain. Looks like Jove's going to make a quick rush. This is so tense if he manages to cap it.
Oh,
I don't know if he's got time. I don't know if he's got time to do it.
It'd
be incredible if he does.
Six VPs remaining. He's in the circle. It is. He's going to get it, Dan. He's going to somehow save this game and keep it going. For the meantime, at least.
All right, well, there's the decap. At least the VP drains have stopped on three. Now he's got to try and deal with the Volks Grenadiers. He's flaming them on the retreat, trying to get the models down as much as possible. Kubel goes down to the Tommy anti-tank rifles on the right-hand side. So Nakano starting to fall apart at the last second. He's going to make a deep push now with the command panel. Oh. The mock target goes on again. Here comes the flank, trying to hit side to rear armor.
He's going to get that rear armor, that juicy spot. Increased pen. Rear armor hits. This thing's a sitting duck.
There it goes. That's got to be GG now.
Also, the Tommy's Vet 3 going to possibly die to the FTG fire coming from the central ground. Definitely GG. Well played by both players. We are heading to a decider ace game of this best of three show match between the two Russian heavyweights, Jove and Nagano.
Yeah, there we go. VP drain going on. Well played, Nagano. That was an incredible game.
Fantastic. Absolutely brilliant. I'm just gonna hats off to both players. They're clearly OKW masters, but you know who's got pick now, Dan? It's Jove.
Do you think he's definitely going to go faction pick?
Yeah. Well, the map's already chosen, so he's got no choice. It's faction pick.
Oh, right. Okay. Predetermined. Because it's effectively like the game five, isn't it? On the standard five.
Yeah, game. That's right.
Yeah. Whew. Huge games. Let's update the score for that. You can talk, by the way. I'm editing.
Oh, yes, I can talk, and I am talking. This is not a best of five. I told these guys they would play a best of three. We could have made it a best of five, in all honesty, but to be honest, I'm just happy that they are playing because they did fall out this week. So it is a very real grudge match. It is hype, and it is an interesting situation. Difficult to even get them to the table, and they're at the table now. It's 1-1, OKW reigning supreme with the two OKW masters, Jove and Nagano from Russia. But of course, Jove now has faction selection on the map Faymanville Approach in the decider of this best of three. Brought to you by Relic Entertainment Incorporated, proud supporters of this community initiative, the Grand Championship Series. Relic have helped us in many ways. Obviously, the Kickstarter is what made this happen. The community is what has made this happen. But Relic are very proud of it. And they're, for example, funding this show match today and other such things. So thank you to them.
It's been a good... it's been a good message to them. Do you know what I mean? Like that the community is still strong. Still wants support, still wants to have competitive play. So it's a big, and it's come at a really good time, of course, because, you know, it's Relic start of the year goes in March, April, isn't it? So, you know, they put forward these things, you know, what are we going to do for the next year? How are we dealing with everything? This is a really good, like, reinforcement, especially for like Kyle and in pushing things he wants to go through. So,
well, of course, Relic Entertainment are an RTS studio, and Coming Heroes is now their only RTS series, because obviously their other games now are MOBA. just joking. We won't talk too much about Dawn of War 3. I'm not a fan. I've chosen not to be a fan because of GCS primarily. But yes, big props to Relic for helping this project when they're also simultaneous release saying Dawn of War 3, and everybody's meant to be looking at that. So my biggest wish is that after about 2 weeks of Dawn of War 3 being out, I hope GCS starts overtaking it on views. And I think it's going to happen.
It'd be interesting. I'm sure they're actually really enjoying that they've got like two of their games that are doing kind of like successful things at the moment. Because it's a good moment for them when they've got the release of a new series. Another old one is doing reasonably well too. We're still waiting for game three to start, and whilst that is happening, we do of course have you guys know what games are coming up today. We've got Von Aston versus Spanky, we've got Andre TC versus Tobis later on today. Imperial Dane's going to be casting Papio, Daniel, and Jeremy. In fact, I can just go over to the schedule here so you guys can see it. Imperial Dane's going to be casting Papio, Daniel versus Jeremy, and Theodosius versus Refero, which I'm really jealous of, if I'm totally honest with you. Because Theodosius is just such a player to watch in this tournament, you know.
I hogged all the good games for us, mate. Honestly, today I've gotten really competitive series. I mean, yesterday I focused on hogging all the name value, but today, I knew that Dane would want to cast like the Wehrmacht flavored guys, but Honestly, we've got some awesome series today. Von Aston and Spanky. That's seed 15 versus seed 16. Sorry, 16 versus 17, rather. That's hype, man. That's like the most competitive first round game in GCS.
Yeah, that should be dead even. Actually, and Pluralita says you get Andre TC, and I think that's absolutely right. Andre TC, like Tobis, came out to me in King of the Hill when he beat Price, and I was like, hey, Tobis, really good player. Andre TC, we've seen before play really good games. Did we see him play, what was it? I think it was actually Trix map contest tournament.
All right.
And I saw Andre play there. I think it was on West Capel, which was Monolithic Bacon's map. And yeah, it was like, he played a really good game. And again, like, these are like first experiences of actually having these players. I like that you just sit up there to be like, ESL list.
I'm sorry.
Just quickly sneaking the logo in, you know? Love that.
No, but, I own a t-shirt. I haven't got any clean ones at the moment.
But yeah, no, you are right, actually. Andre is a really good player. All the games here like are going to be good, but my eye in this tournament is definitely like on Theodosius, because it's just, you know, the way that he treated Jove in that 1v1 last week, or 2 weeks ago rather, was just incredible.
Oh yeah, well it's better to have your eye. I'd be really upset if he accidentally loses, but he's up against the 28 seed. He's number 5 seed. Referro is a good player. In fact, there are no bad players in GCS, so I'm going to put that out there. They're all top 100 auto match, and they're all, you know, trained for this tournament. But we you know, it's going to be just a great day of action. There's no way you can look at it that's a bad game today, a bad match. You either got really cool players you want to see, or you've got really competitive matches that are just going to be awesome to watch. So very exciting indeed.
Still no game 3 yet.
No, not quite.
Do you reckon they've just put down their mouse and keyboard and just having like fisticuffs? And then
Well, Nagano says he is thinking, and I said, okay, thanks. Is he thinking how to spell OKW? Honestly, this chat between us three has been so hilarious. It's been great. I'll just put into chat, I won't say what they've been saying to each other, because quite frankly, it's a very personal argument between the two, but that's what I said in Russian to them from Google Translate. I believe K-Pen's translated it earlier on. It actually says, stop it now, both of you. We will pay you today to play a stupid game, a stupid computer game, but postpone your differences for the next 2 hours and become athletic men, it says. It's meant to say sportsmen. But it says become athletic men.
We should have got Maza involved, you know? We should have got Maza to do all of this for us.
Ratata, please play. Ratata, Russia. Something like that.
Hopefully Maza is probably going to pick up replays of this as well and cast them. Maza is another community member. He casts pretty much the same that we do, but in Russian. And I really, the guy is absolutely hilarious, but he does like such a huge part for the Russian community. If you guys get a chance to check him out on Twitch, I'd definitely say do that. Whilst we've got some spare time, whilst we've got some downtime, I saw there was some people in the channel, by the way, who are new to Company of Heroes. And if you are new, then, you know, welcome to the community. We're another one of Relic's RTS, if you've come from Dawn of War, as I saw in chat a minute ago. It's a similar kind of thing, but it's the games are more kind of like slow and thought out, and it's more like deep strategy. Micro over
can
macro.
Can I hype it up way more and just completely down talk Dawn of War?
You can, after you let me announce that there is a raffle.
Oh, okay, awesome. So, exclamation mark raffle for your chance to win. What, Dan? What are they winning?
Ashes of the Singularity.
Oh, okay, we're doing that one. We have got commanders as well to give away.
We have commanders as well. We're going to do Ashes of the Singularity first.
Basically, why Company of Heroes is an absolutely amazing RTS series is in 2006, Relic pretty much innovated an entire new genre of game. They innovated what I like to call the Relic RTS, where you've got retreat mechanics, you've got deep flanking maneuvers with individual squad mechanics based on FPS, an engine. It's originally based on a heavily modified Unreal engine. So you've got cover, you've got so much cool strategy and strategic depth and tactical play that you will just never see in another RTS as long as you live. And it's been proven now that Company Heroes 1 and 2, and also kind of Dawn of War 2, are the only games to really utilize this kind of thinking, this kind of mode of thinking that makes RTS games, in my mind, a hell of a lot deeper, a hell of a lot more thought-provoking and interesting to watch on a competitive level. Like, I promise you, if you tune into the stream today, stick around. If you see competitive Company Heroes 2 played properly, it literally blows so many other competitive games out of the water. It's awesome. There's a reason that me and Dan have been doing this for so damn long. It's just because we just can't quit you, man. That was not the quote from Brokeback Mountain, was it? But anyway, that's what it was meant to be. It's a great game. So yeah, stick around. You're going to love it.
All right, okay, we're going to do the raffle announcement winner. You guys have had long enough. You didn't hear it before. You got a couple of seconds for exclamation mark raffle. I'm going to close it in about 10 seconds. This is for a copy of Ashes of the Singularity. Thank you very much for Callum from General's Gentleman, who is now... Is he a developer at that studio, did you say?
He is, actually. Yes, he is a developer and lead, balance design as well.
One second.
So yeah, Callum's have been picked up by a studio on the west coast of America, maybe even moving if things go right for him. He's given us 20 keys so far to give away for Ashes of the Singularity, Supreme Commander-inspired RTS, which is another great game in my mind. That was another one that innovated the field quite a lot. Ashes of the Singularity looks really cool, so if you want something that's a little bit different to Company Heroes, maybe pick that up, and this is your chance to win a key.
Ransomar 1, you were the...
That is the ring dial, which means Ransom R1, you have won the raffle.
I genuinely have to take this call. I'll be back in a second.
Yes, we're just having a call from Callum Studios. I always forget the name of the studios. Hang on. But yes, that's right. The call has been said that Random has now been invited to play an incredible RTS game, Ashes of the Singularity. Yes, big news for GCS tournaments. We've nearly reached £6,000 on the Kickstarter. Great thing about this Kickstarter is all the money from the Kickstarter will go back into the tournament in one way or another, via assets for the tournament, via the production quality, via the live events, but mainly for the player pool. The player pool of cash. The cash pool, that's it. The cash prize for the players. God, my mind's crazy. But anyway, yes, indeed. We're now up to, that's right, £1,400 for the winner, £650 for the runner-up, £300 for third place, £140 for fourth place, £60 for the quarterfinal losers, that's fifth to eighth, and £100 for the trophy. And it is part of the prize pool, the trophy, because the player gets to keep the damn thing. Also, on top of that, we've got £50 for bonus awards, which will be voted for and on by fans. I have seen the copypastas going on in chat. Let me do my Dane impression. Let me get into the mode of Dane. Stuck, 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 stuck. Laughing in the background. Something crazy going on.
Sorry. Okay. I assume game three is going to start soon. I just have to make a very quick phone call. It is serious, but it's going to be okay. I don't have to do anything. And I'll just go over to a wait screen and then we'll just jump straight into the game.
Okay. Can you get into reserve party and call whilst I'm going to start, and then pause it. Yeah. Good. Yes, so we don't lose the game.
Yeah. Yeah. No problem at all.
I will entertain the chat. I have plenty of things to discuss.
Oh, okay. Sure.
It's fine. Yeah. Quite fresh. So yeah, we're currently loading in. We're going to get paused up. Dan's got a job where if he gets called, he has to take the phone call. It's part of his job. He's more like a superhero, I think, or something. I don't quite know. He's never actually told me. The Dane impression actually requires a little bit of warming up, K-Pen. I can never get it right first time. So let me just practice it off mute, and then maybe I can get it working. Hang on. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Yeah, I'm not a dancing bear, Pluralitas. I won't dance for you until I've had my beers that are in the fridge. So if you want to stick around for dancing, you can have a bit of that later. Dan hasn't paused the game. Oh, for fuck's sake. I wonder what's showing on stream at the moment. He's not paused it. He's meant to pause it. What has he done? Oh, for God's sake. Oh, that is silly, isn't it? We're going to have to restart it and then jump back into it. So pretend that's not happened. GCS does have the highest production qualities in the world, but sometimes real life beckons and Dan's had to take a phone call. Yes, indeed. So AE will be releasing his self-recorded song, Ode to Verabooz. It shall be coming out soon. I can give you a little snippet of that if you like, if you just want to hang on for one moment, but I can't because I'm using push to speak today. A little bit more difficult to accomplish. Dan, pause the game. Yep, there we go. I'm just telling you to pause the game, that's all. I can make a judgment call based on that. No, don't. It's fine. No, it's fine. Have you done that already? Don't. It's fine. Don't. Keep pause it, though, so we can do a proper intro.
Sure. Damn. All right, you ready? You ready?
Yeah, I'll do an intro if that's okay.
All right, we're live.
Hello there, and welcome to Game 3 decided between Jove and Nagano. Just missed the first minute of action. Stern Pioneers tried to rush the house. They were wrestled for contention between the conscripts. That's right. The conscripts of Jove. He had choice on Famenville approach, but he's decided to play Soviets against his former friend, and in this case, very real, bitter enemy, because these guys have fallen out in real life, legitimately. Storm Pioneers finding the south side of the van there, depleting that squad very, very fiercely. Dan, how do you see this matchup going?
Yeah, it's a nice one. It's good to see Jove play straight into Tier 2, getting the conscript straight away for that extra bit of capping. Not doing the three engineer build that we've seen from both Nagano and Von Ivan in the tournament so far. Jove clearly playing to his strength. As you said earlier, he hasn't read the patch notes, so maybe he's not going to be aware of some of the changes that have happened to this tier specifically.
Yeah, this guy, he doesn't read very good English. I explained to him the main patch note differences in GCS and gave him the choice of playing it or not. And they ended up playing on it, but the fact is, communicating before this game, these guys were so close to not playing today. They were fiercely giving each other very big insults in Russian letters that they didn't think I could read, so it wasn't just for show. But yes, this is the Game 3 decider. Jove decided to go Soviets. Nagano's on OKW. What a game it's going to be. What a match-up it's been so far as well.
It's a nice opener for the day, and it's... You know, we always talk about this with the Tier 2. So Tier 2 is one of these that's very, very slow to pop up. I was actually surprised when I came back. And apologies, by the way. I just had something very, very serious happen at work, which I had to take a direct phone call for. It's very, very slow to get on the field. One of the benefits we always talk about with the Tier 2, although it's slow, although you lose the early game map control, it does give you a very, very powerful set of units to take the field back with. And a player like Jove, who is controlled and has that kind of precision and eye for direction with his units, is going to be able to utilize this tier very, very effectively. A great little pushback from Nagano there to defend the fuel. May get lucky and take some of the engineers out on the retreat.
Didn't quite manage to pull it off, but I think Joe's showing some great work with the conscripts here. He does, of course, have the Maxim out. It is of the new Maxim, which has got MG42-like suppression, a wider cone of fire, but it doesn't have that instant suppression the Maxim used to have, and it doesn't have the ability to just spin around with its super traverse and pin things instantly. So it's an interesting unit. Should be better support unit, but not as spammable.
Nagano's actually chosen to go Battle Grouper first this time round. So last game we saw him play against the Brits with a quick mechanized regiment, making use of the medical supplies from the Stern Pioneers. This time he's straight into Battle Grouper. I think he also went straight into healing. So he may be looking at something that, you know, revolves in a higher infantry game. Maybe looking at Scavenge Doctrine. But he's definitely prepping up to have a lot of infantry engagements on the field right now.
There you go, Maxim's Hatsis retreat. Jove not using it to its full potential there. And a part of me is scared now, and I absolutely promise everybody in chat, Jove was clearly told both in English and Russian. The GCS patch does change several things. Play on it if you want. If you haven't read the notes, do not play on it. He's used the Maxims possibly to get a win over his bitter arch nemesis, Nagano, his former friend. And maybe he didn't realize the Maxim's now a different beast, a different animal. So it's going to be interesting to see if he can make it work. And if anybody can make it work, it's Jove, but his conscript just nearly burnt to death.
That was an incredible engagement. Nagano had absolute balls of steel to stay in that. Took the Molotov, low health against three men against five, and managed to throw the incendiary grenade and force a one-man model low health retreat from Jove. So very, very good play there from Nagano, winning a seemingly unwinnable engagement.
So it's interesting that Jove, a former double grandmaster of the game, is now on Soviets, a slightly changed Soviets with a different Maxim machine gun. That's two of the changes that happened in the GCS patch, the Maxim machine gun and, of course, the M4C Sherman. He's now going to try and make it work. He will at least have access to the Ziskun quite early on, so if we see a fast Lux, at least he'll have something to answer it with.
It's actually going to be the Flak half-track that's going to be the rush here. Might take a little bit too long to get up to Mechanized and then the Lux, even though it would be a good idea. He could still counter it with Mines and AT guns relatively well. Flak half-track is a little bit like a mini Tier 4, and it's going to make it very, very difficult for Jove to actually push in. I mean, interestingly as well, you know, the AT gun comes out, that's fine. You know, the Flak half-track can move away. But we've already seen Molotovs teched from Jove. This could force Jove to tech into 18 aids as well. So this is going to really, really harass the fuel income of Jove. He's already low on resources. If he's going to want to start countering this, and that will prevent things like Tier 3 from coming in quickly. So it's a good position for Nagano.
Extremely good position from Nagano. This grudge match is going his way at the moment. He's winning on victory points. He's got superior map control. Yes, Joe's got to start really thinking outside the box and really start using his arguably superior micro. He has had a lot more hours in the game than Nagano, so it could be said that he's got better mechanics.
Nagano has just spotted some mines going down there from the engineers, and of course engineers without their veteran C3. In fact, veteran C3 is one of those things for engineers where they stop taking damage whilst repairing. I also wonder if that's the same for planting mines and building. I don't know if anyone knows the answer to that, because that's definitely not written on the notes that I've been reading.
Here you go, Nagano's got the handbrake ability utilized from the half track, allowing it to keep its favorable side facing. It's one of those features. Nagano is very quick to pick up on that because he's one of those guys that plays both 1 versus 1, 2 versus 2, of both Company Heroes 1 and 2. So he's very, very malleable and can pick up differences in the game very quickly. Makes him a very tactically superior player at times.
Oh, great opening there from Flak Half-Track, wiping so many models after deploying, forcing that conscript squad right back through the negative retreat. Negative cover on the road against the Volkswagen is.
If you could show the angle between that wall where the half track was and the wall where the conscripts were. For everybody watching, cover in Company of Heroes is directional. So it calculates where you are in a line with where your opponent is. And if there's no cover to be had, it does not work. It is all simulated. And that's a perfect example.
Jove's doing very well here to push up on the fuel. It seems like Nagano is finding it a little bit difficult to get Jove's Maxim out of the house there, which is defending that fuel point. Trying to go for some deep flanks with the Sturm Pioneers, and he should be able to push off the flamethrower engineers from Jove on the right VP. Very difficult game to play back from Jove. There's so much ground in the start of the game.
Yeah, he really has. He's got a lot of work to do. He does now have the Ziss anti-tank gun out. He's not quite in position at the moment, but the handbrake mode's now on and set up this truck. So he's got two shots, possibly get rid of it.
Oh, yes, Jove trying to get the ground attack through the hedgerow there. Even though there's a line of sight blocker, still trying to use that ability to hit the enemy is attacking our HQ. Hit the Flak half-track through there. There's always an interesting mechanic, when we were speaking about it yesterday, I think, you know, the sight blockers, not shot blockers, and there's lots of this around. It's Monolithic Bacon I was talking about it with, and just the potentials for gameplay of this is absolutely lovely. It's kind of where you get the top players really excelling and overperforming.
Okay, so nice use of the Maxim here. He's able to suppress two units and change between them. It's got a little bit better traverse than it had in an early GCS patch. However, this Volkswagen does manage to get to the green cover and is able to sustain itself. Infiltration grenades go in and push it away. Dan, could you please hover over the Maxim's Vet 1 ability to show the viewers what it does? It's called Sustained Fire, and it gives it twice the ammunition in terms of firepower in a long period. So it'll just continuously fire in one big long burst. And it's a really good ability, better DPS over time, and of course, better suppression over time.
I bet Joe's got this machine gun and thinking, what on earth is this? This is completely different from what I was expecting.
It's very possible. I mean, part of me would hope that that isn't the case, because we did give him the choice, but certainly he's definitely learning the unit. He's got done some good damage with it, though. He's got up to Veteran C1 already, getting that sustained fire unlocked.
Well, having a look at the options here, we've got Nagano, who's once again with the Special Operations Doctrine. It's a very comfortable thing for him to play because he can go Mechanized and Battle Grouper and still get that late game at Panther as a call-in. Jove's going to go Guard Motor. And did he bring out the HM120? Oh, good, yes. So this is one of the things I'm surprised we haven't seen more of this Doctrine so far, because it is still a very good Doctrine, even though I think Guards had a price increase, did they? Looks like they're still 360. But I mean, it's a very, very good Doctrine. The HM120 is just absolute killer. You don't get more squad wipes from Mortars, I think, than this one.
Tank Heavy Battalion Command coming up in base for Jove. He's already getting his Tier 3 out, so he has had some fuel. Obviously, it's not an early Tank Heavy Battalion Command, but it's just about 12 minutes, so it's not too late. And he is still in this game, despite lacking on victory points. But this ain't quite about victory points yet. It is the deciding ace game. And this may be about just trying to win, quite frankly. So if he can survive to the late game, get his T-34-85s up, maybe he can make a go of it.
It's going to be really difficult for him to do that, because I think he probably has to invest in Tier 3 if he's going to just take advantage of the mid-game. If he could rely on his micro in a Tier 3 unit, he may be able to start pushing enough territories back that he can get resources to go Tier 4, but it's a bit of a gamble if he goes straight to Tier 4 now, because it's going to give Nagano the opportunity to just keep rolling mid-tier vehicles. So there we go, T-70s in the pipeline for Jove. I think that's a sensible decision.
It really is, and it must be said at this point, he's not actually lost that much. In fact, he's lost no units, has Joe. So despite his lack of map control, his economy and his army is not actually that bad. He's getting his T-70 out, he's got his Zis out, he's got a good amount of veterancy to make his units a little bit more sustainable on the field. So it's not looking too bad for him, in all honesty.
It's just one of those things. You lose a lot of VPs in the start of the game. The pressure is on a little bit more than you would like it to be, but he still has a lot of options, and it's just about how he plays them now, how he makes the uses of that. T-70's now hit the field, and it looks like Jove has taken his army to the left-hand side, going to try and take that fuel where Nagano's been a little less present, but the 80 gun in anticipation of that flak half-track, just waiting over the fuel, and should be able to go and cap it with the conscripts relatively comfortably.
Yeah, despite what's happening, Joe's showing expert levels of gamemanship here. He's trying to make things very comfortable. He's got the T-70 rocking in for the flak off track again with the pop smoke. Fourth time it's used that in this game, the concealing smoke for 25 munitions to get away. It's working very well. Elsewhere, the T-70 is now reversing into the MG-34 and eats a Faust for its troubles.
Yeah, it hasn't really got anything to worry about unless it just takes numerous Fausts. And goes down, but it's not going to happen. The T-70 is still okay where it is on the field. It needs to get those engineers over there. They're currently capping strategic points on the right-hand side of the map.
You can do that. Or possibly wait for him to be out of combat and get that 30 munitions to get the vehicle crew repair up that he gets as part of his commander. So yeah, he will be able to get that T-70 back on the field, and that's what he needs to do, Dan. He can't relinquish the field for too long because he's already dropping to half victory points. Guards,
troops ready for action. And finally, we just see guards come on the field now from Jove.
We have had 200 extra viewers tune in. This is a Russian show match between Jove and Nagano. This is big stuff. This is the deciding ace game. The score is 1-1. This is for £70 for the winner, £30 for the runner-up, £100 prize pool provided by Relic Entertainment. These guys have legitimately and genuinely fallen out this week. It was extremely difficult to get them to play today. They were giving all kinds of Russian expletives to each other in the chat on the build-up. This is a grudge match, a legitimate grudge match. This is big stuff. Jove has gone for Soviets. I'm not sure he fully understood the GCS patch notes. We tried to explain it to him. He has, however, gotten his newly nerfed Maxim to Veterancy 2, 4 kills. So it's definitely doing some work, and it's been doing some good suppression in this game.
Given how well he did with OKW in the first game, and given how well Nagano did with OKW in the second, I would have thought Jove would have just picked OKW to, you know, have something he played very comfortably and stop Nagano from playing that. I don't understand this decision at all. We've just seen an infantry unit go down for Nagano somewhere on the map there, so it looks like Jove is winning some of the engagements. Drops a conscript squad of his own, though, unfortunately.
Oh. So, first loss of the game for him, actually, that conscript. He's been so good with the preservation up to this point. And to be honest, I think he may be able to start pushing when he gets his tier 4 up, especially.
Do you really think he's going to go for that tier 4, though? Because the last game, he actually played the heavy light vehicles and straight into that command panther. So I'd be interested if we do see tier 4.
No, Jove tier 4.
T-75s,
yeah. I mean, Nagano's been pushing the initiative the entire game. I just think Jove, he'll have to probably keep just leading victory points for a while, although he has actually capping the center at the moment. But here comes the cloaked rocket into contest, doesn't quite get it, and it is now neutral. T-70's coming in for a poke. It's coming to have a little feel for what's there, just take a little bit of splash damage from the Black Hawk track.
Dangerous situation. A lot of damage. Yeah, the main gun's just been destroyed there. The Puma's going to come around and try and take a shot. There's no defense for the T-70. That is going to go down. AT gun's going to get a couple of shots on the Puma to try and force it back a little bit, but it's a huge loss for Jove, who's now building the SU-76, clearly feeling entrapped in Tier 3.
By the way, I believe the 120mm has taken out the Sturm Pioneers. So there you go, it's got 6 kills, it's paid for itself with a brutal shot picked up by chat. Because the guy's not casting, it can sometimes pick up peripheral things, because they have the beauty of not...
When he lost his infantry squad, that's what it was.
Oh, sorry, never, don't worry, I didn't hear you, sorry, it's alright.
That's right.
SU-76 in the
just
build.
Just don't read chat.
I find it actually very useful sometimes, it really does help sometimes. But I do agree, I probably shouldn't read it as much as I do. Flamethrower in the south there. MG34's got a difficult retreat path. One more lick, possibly. Will he get it? Moz in the gun. Can't quite do it. Flamer can't quite do it. MG34 gets out of there. That would have been a steal, Dan.
That was really unfortunate, actually. They just didn't really turn the weapon fast enough to get the burst off. Very lucky lucky retreat from Nagano. He should have lost that.
Really should have. It was very unfortunate. The suppression just about stopped those combat engines not having what they needed. By the way,
great incendiary grenades in that building. He just managed to get out with the Maxim. Oh. Very, very close call there.
Really want to see sustained fire. So we just hear Mazza on stream just going rat-a-ta-ta-ta, but twice as long. Conscript's trying to protect all these support weapons from these rampaging folks grenadiers. SU-76 does have infantry crush.
Weird that he actually drove in to take a Faust there, which is an interesting decision. I don't know whether he was trying to buy time for the conscripts to deal some damage, or whether he just wanted to try and whittle down some of Nagano's munitions, but it looked like he intentionally went into that. He was definitely microing units that were around there. Interesting to see that one. But demo charge planted on munitions left. I think it was blown early or detected by the Minesweeper Sturm Pioneers there, and blown when seen.
Now we've got Nagano with wrestling control of the center, meaning Jove has now fallen to 200 victory points. Just double check the stats there. Of course, the SU-76 does have infantry crush, so he's possibly going for it. Terrible turning circle on that vehicle. That is one of the ways that we've crush has been nerfed a little bit for some vehicles in this match. Oh, Puma's coming in to push away the conscripts. Molotov did go in against the Sturm Pioneers, but did manage to vacate the garrison.
very, very dangerous. I wonder if these Stone Pioneers might try and close the gap to wipe those last two models. Doesn't see it, though. Doesn't manage to go in and grab those. We've got Barrage going in on the Raketen in the center, which has managed to hold the cap for quite some time now and should. Oh, gets taken down by the long-range AP shot. That was a great barrage. Yeah, very, very lucky. And did you notice he very sneakily got a shot off on the flak half track as well as that was going away?
It's great.
That's great. He managed pro AT gun.
That's the advantage of having a six-man squad handling one support weapon, you know? They can be like, would you get the anti-tank ammunition ready just so we can hot swap it after we've finished with the anti-infantry? It was a really good swapping there. Oops, God, the photo grenades nearly died there because they were salvaging.
That was incredibly risky because those squads would have gone down if the AoE had even touched them there. They were already low health. Bear in mind the extra damage they get whilst repairing. Incredibly risky move with a squad.
I think Stukasapusa has got to be the way to go now for Nagano, in my opinion, because you've got a Vet 2 Maxim, Vet 2 Aziz gun. High priority targets for a Stukasapusa would be great to see that weapon.
Yeah, I do think you're right. He used it very well against support play last game, and we saw, didn't we, that his prediction for landing shots was very, very on point. I just think he's going to be keen to go into that command path. He seems to be managing everything relatively well.
Here you go. These guys do have anti-tank grenades. He's going to be able to get the flak half track. This could be the end of that vehicle. He's been on the field for a very long time. Didn't quite manage to get the wind up. There you go. He has managed to get it now. He's going to go through the smoke. Did get it, but it's too late now. It's beyond the smoke, and the SU-76 can't quite get there.
I think he's going to be really unhappy with that because the AT gun just missed the shot. The projectile didn't quite connect with that flak half track, and that would have been the end. That would have killed it.
The 120mm now is up to 9 kills. Clearly starting to pay for itself elsewhere. Vet 4 STGs are coming for this Zis gun. They can't quite get their shield in front of themselves. They could be losing their veterancy.
Yeah, of course, he's keeping that on retreat, which is good. He has left his HM120 a little bit too long. That's going to get wiped. I wonder if this is going to be a steal for Nagano. That's definitely a high-value unit. I'd love to see him try and take it.
Oh, Maxim to the rescue. Vet 3 now, Maxim. The newly, supposedly, according to the forums, nerfed Maxim. I don't quite frankly see it. I think the utility this thing has is quite frankly great. Big cone of fire, can still suppress. And look, it's rescued the 120mm.
Really good response from Jove there. He could have lost that HM120, but he managed to get suppression down to stop that from happening. Now he's also chasing things down in retreat, trying to make the most that he can out of a low health retreat in the squad. But we do have the Command Panther on the field now. It's chasing up, going straight for that SU-76, and there's only protection from an AT gun and the guards. Hopefully he can get button vehicle, but he hasn't actually upgraded to the DP-28, so that isn't going to happen. Command Panther is going to easily be able to retreat from that engagement.
I think listening to your pattern of speech there, you started with only, but then I think just like Nagano, you realised that that was a no situation for the Panther. It seemed like only an SU-76, then only guards, and then it was a Zis gun as well, so three things pushing him away.
It's one of those things you have with the benefit of changing the camera angle. I was on standard camera angle, I'm like, there's only this, and then you tilt it down a little bit, you're like, I don't think we should go there.
Yeah, exactly. Simulating the fog of war from the player's perspective. I quite liked it, to be honest. It was like, there's only this and that. Reverse. It's time to reverse now.
Indeed. We get a little bit of extra intel that the players don't necessarily always see, which is interesting. But I mean, quick reflexes, because of course he goes in there, he's on full throttle as well. You know, bear in mind if he does drive in at that kind of speed, he has to stop, slow down, then reverse. So he had quick reactions to get out of that situation.
I always think it's very impressive for me as well, because you have to deal with the latency. You've always got, 400 milliseconds of ping to deal with. So, it's always impressive to me.
Been a lot of barrages from the SU-76 there. It's actually most of the game he's been utilizing barrage as much as possible. Joe's now going into his tier 4. This is so late. 24-minute tier 4 going up. And he hasn't even got the fuel really to just get the T-34-85s out straight away, so he may end up just bringing out a 76, which isn't going to do that much against the Command Panther. It's definitely looking like it might be GG here.
Yeah, it does look likely. I think Jove's lack of ability to read English has really let him down. because we told him he had choice, and he didn't choose OKW, which he's, they're both players are clearly stronger as OKW. I know Joe's a five faction grandmaster, but yeah, it's an odd one. Still been a great match, great series, two great players that we're not going to see in the GCF tournament proper due to elements out of their control. One's been conscripted into the army. The other guy has got university end exams that he can't shift around, of course.
Jove is really, really desperate, constantly just trying to go for decaps, even though he knows he's going to lose manpower with retreating the squads. Panther here is going to try and block the squad a little bit at the same time, taking down the SU-76. And given the Vok's going to do is like a couple of extra seconds there just to try and wipe some more models. And Jove's going to surrender. He knows that it is the end. GG Nagano.
Yeah, GG Nagano. I predict... Jove messaged me. I did not know the Maxim is shit. I thought it was all right, you know. I think what he didn't meant to say is I didn't know the Maxim can't just win you the game automatically anymore. Because he probably couldn't realize he couldn't spam them. That's just an unfortunate situation. By the way, I told the players to play in live. I just said, because Jove doesn't seem to understand, I said play in live. Didn't seem to quite get that. Trying to get two angry Russians to play each other has been more stressful for me than trying to get the entire Grand Championship Series to work yesterday.
Yeah, I'm really glad that they did play, though. And if either Nagano or Jove is watching, of course, then well played. Thanks for putting on good games. It's such a shame, again, that they're not in the tournament, but it's nice that they've had a little bit of a spot in the limelight to assert their dominance. But they're two very, very good players. Pleasure to cast them always.
We probably go for... did we announce the raffle winner? We did, didn't we? We got Ashes of the Singularity. Oh, don't forget, by the way, the bottom one. Tick that off, please. We gave that to Dr. Wox for being a fantastic bloke.
I haven't given out the codes yet. I'll do that later tonight. So just relay that to me then. Yeah.
Okay.
So we're pretty soon coming into the basically the start of GCS day two. This, of course, was a separate to the Grand Championship Series, even though we're casting it under this banner right now. But if you don't mind, AE, there's a couple of things that I need to sort out on stream. So if you don't mind that we go over to the wait screen and then just start up fresh at 3 o'clock.
Yeah, absolutely fine.
Yeah.
Cool things. No worry.
All right, fantastic. Well, guys, thanks for tuning in so far. Don't go anywhere because we have got loads more games today. The rest are going to be best of fives. Von Aston versus Spanky is the next series. And then later on tonight, we have Andre versus Tobis. All of these are going to be really interesting games. Seeds are a little closer together, I believe you said, for these. So they're going to be a very, very close skill, lots of action. So we'll see you guys very, very shortly.